There's a growing recognition about the prevalence of sexual assault on college campuses, and it seems new headlines each week, including the high-profile investigations currently underway at the University of Virginia. One major factor that's getting less attention and yet accompanies many cases is the volume of drinking happening on or near campus. That is our focus tonight. Gwen has a conversation we recorded earlier this week.
The scenes you find of college parties on the web and in the movies play up the fun, the rowdy moments, the sheer animal house craziness of campus life. But a recently renewed discussion about rape allegations has thrown a fresh spotlight onto the dark side of problems associated with excessive drinking at institutions of higher learning. More than 1,800 students die each year from alcohol-related incidents. 600,000 students have been injured while drunk, and nearly 100,000 sexual assaults have been reported that were linked to alcohol intoxication. We talk with two people who have seen the problem close up. Jonathan Gibralter is the president of Frostburg State University in Maryland, which has about 5,000 students. He's the co-chair of a college president's working group to address student drinking. And Beth McMurtrie is with the Chronicle of Higher Education. She's part of a team that just finished a special series, Alcohol's Hold on Campus. Welcome to you both.
Thank you.
We just talked about death, injury, sexual assault, President Gibralter. Of those three, which would you say are the biggest consequence of excessive drinking?
I think all of them are the biggest consequence of excessive drinking. And excessive drinking is the thing that I think brings about a lot of these related harms to a lot of college students today. And I consider every one of them to be extremely serious.
Beth McMurtrie, wasn't this declared a problem in the 1990s? I am certain this is not the first conversation we've had about drinking on campus, yet here we are again.
I know, and I think that's the thing that struck me as I was reporting this story. If you go back in time to the 90s and even earlier, you see that this was part of a national conversation. And millions of dollars and hundreds of task forces and so many efforts have been put into this issue over the years to try to address the problem of dangerous drinking on college campuses. But when you look at the data and you look at the binge drinking rates among college students, not a whole lot has changed.
So why didn't the problem, as identified, turn into action?
Well, I think there has been action over the years, and I think what you see among colleges is that they tend to focus on education as a means for changing students' behavior. This idea that if you give students the right information, that they'll make wiser choices. But the research has shown that education without enforcement and without intervention, without trying to control the flow of alcohol on campus, really has a very limited and a very short-term effect.
Okay, let's ask President Gibralter about that. You've been part of this commission, but you also have to see this every single day in your job.
I think, and Beth is exactly right, I think that the important thing to recognize is that in colleges and universities every year, you have a new group of freshmen. So it's a new educational process. Beyond that, though, just educating young people alone isn't enough. It's got to be a comprehensive initiative to approach this problem, and that includes both working with the local community, working with your college or university community, working with your alumni, but it also has to include deterrence. At Frostburg State, we have a collaborative law enforcement agreement. And our university police work closely with several different law enforcement agencies to work off campus and be able to work with, to really get at adjudicating these young people who get citations for off-campus behavior.
And yet, Beth McMurtrie, in the series that you did in the Chronicle of Higher Education, there's a term that caught my eye called the organized collegiate drinking infrastructure. That's to say, the fraternities, the sororities, the party culture, tailgating, you name it. How do you tackle that, especially when it's so much part of the identity? And even an Ivy League school like Yale, where 62% of the students said they binge drink.
Right. Well, I want to start out by saying this is a huge cultural issue. It's not just a college issue. And so colleges do inherit this problem. But as you pointed out, there are a lot of constituencies that are kind of actively working against efforts to control alcohol. I think the simple answer is it requires leadership, because this is in some ways a political issue.
On campus.
If you're going to take on the fraternity system, if if you're going to take on the tailgating structure, the booster structure, you really have to, or if you're going to go out, as Frostburg did, into the community and look at what's happening off campus with bar owners and liquor stores, you really need a high-level support to be able to tackle those very complicated and sometimes political issues.
So is it just a matter that the colleges or the law enforcement are just looking the other way? The laws exist, the rules exist, and they're just looking the other way?
I don't think they're looking the other way. I think that these are just incredibly difficult issues. You know, you deal perhaps with a fraternity or a sorority, perhaps off campus, and there is a culture around these organizations that makes it extremely difficult for law enforcement to actually walk in and be able to have an impact. I think that, I mean, at Frostburg State, when I arrived in 2006, the reported high-risk drinking rate was at about 59%. 59% of all students said they drink more than five drinks in any one sitting. We've been able to
get drinks.
Five drinks in over a period of 2 or 3 hours.
Wow.
Now it's down to 41%. We've been able to move the mark below the national average.
How?
Through a combination of deterrence, education, and working with local bar owners, working with landlords, and really trying to provide a comprehensive program for our students.
When it comes to campus sexual assault, which we've been talking about a lot involving University of Virginia and the flawed story that Rolling Stone ran, but still raised questions about behavior, does drinking contribute to the inability of a woman to defend herself, especially if she drinks, is drunk, becomes a victim in one way or another, and looks like she, and the blame then shifts to the victim?
Well, you raised a very interesting issue. Studies have shown that about 3/4 of sexual assaults on campuses involve alcohol. So we know that they're closely correlated. But historically, colleges have not talked about drinking or not talked about alcohol when they talk to students about preventing sexual assault. And I think the reason is they're worried that they're going to end up sounding like they're blaming the victim. Mm. They already have trouble getting victims to come forward, and so they don't want to send this message that, well, it's up to you, right? It's up to you to, if you drink too much, you might be putting yourself at risk of assault. And yet, that is a fact. And so colleges are wrestling with how to talk to students about the reality of dangerous drinking without sounding like they're blaming them.
President Gibralter, how do colleges tackle this now and avoid the issue fatigue, perhaps, that stopped the conversation from moving to some better place last time?
Again, every year it's a new group of freshmen, so it's a new conversation every year. And for me, taking a leadership position on this at my campus is extremely important. That empowers other people to be able to do their jobs. And so neither I nor my university faculty and staff become fatigued of me talking about this topic. It's important.
But if I'm a parent, I'm a little fatigued or at least scared of sending my child to your school if I think that that's what's going to happen.
And you should be concerned, because it is a cultural part of many colleges and universities. And what I do during our orientation programs and during our open houses where parents and their sons and daughters visit is I tell parents that they need to be a part of this conversation. We need their help and support.
President Jonathan Gibralter of Frostburg State University and Beth McMurtrie of the Chronicle of Higher Education. Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.